In this presentation, I hope to share with you the megatrends. The megatrends in the petrochemicals market. After all, petrochemical sector accounts for around 10% of global crude oil demand. So what are the megatrends in the petrochemicals market? The feedstock picture has changed in the past few years with plummeting oil prices. So first of all, looking at developments in crude oil and natural gas. The biggest influence on petrochemical prices globally is crude as a key feedstock to petrochemicals. However, 40% of petrochemicals are made from alternative feedstocks, and most of that comes from the natural gas stream. The chart which you can see here is the price of crude against the price of natural gas from 1994. There was a positive correlation between gas and crude oil prices prior to 2008. However, since around this time, US shale gas production has grown rapidly, adding to global natural gas production and pressuring down prices. And this led to a divergence in prices between crude oil and natural gas. Petrochemical producers using natural gas now had a big cost advantage. More recently, however, this cost advantage disappeared as crude prices fell from around $120 per barrel back in 2012, and now we're trending around the $50 mark. This has, of course, had a direct impact on naphtha and ethane, which are derived from oil and natural gas, respectively. So the chart here shows the most recent trends in naphtha and ethane. When oil prices were over $100 per barrel, naphtha prices were also high. However, as crude prices tumbled, naphtha prices followed. So this greatly narrowed the spread between naphtha and ethane, which are the most prominent feedstocks for petrochemicals. To fully understand the impact of feedstock price changes, it's useful to look at the various cracker yields by feedstocks. So here we have the main feedstocks, gas oil, naphtha, gasoline, butane, propane, and ethane. And each bar shows the breakdown of what proportions of each petrochemical product can be derived from each. Ethylene is the product colored in gray. Ethylene is one of the most important petrochemicals, as it is the core building block to produce a vast range of petrochemicals. Ethane yields the most ethylene, just under 80%, but yields a much smaller proportion of other products, such as aromatics. On the other hand, naphtha yields only around 30% of ethylene, but yields a much higher proportion of other products like propylene, butadiene, and aromatics. What the narrowing price trends in naphtha and ethane have meant is that the costs to produce ethylene have declined over the years. So here, just touching on what's happening in the Russian and Eastern European petrochemicals market, the trend is to build more cracker capacity to make use of the country's abundant gas reserves. As you can see here, many of the new crackers have more than 1 million metric tons of capacity. They're much larger than the ones currently in operation and will therefore benefit from economies of scale, will be more efficient and much lower cost. The problem, of course, is that the timeline of these new crackers is still very unclear. As you can appreciate, it's very costly and it's a very complex job to build a cracker. But the strategy for Russian companies is to move down the value chain and to build more downstream polymer capacity so that the industry becomes more self-sufficient in polymers, where the value is, and less reliant on imports. So if all the cracker capacity that are listed here, if they all come on stream, we can expect about 2 million metric tons of new polyethylene, of new polymer capacity in Russia in the next few years. But the message here is that despite all these gas-based cracker expansions in Russia, but also all over the world, it's important to remember that the competitive edge that producers had by using natural gas no longer is there due to lower crude oil prices. But for now, moving to the Middle East, how has Middle Eastern companies adapted to a low feedstock environment and the US shale gas boom? Integration is the new buzzword for Middle Eastern producers. In the Middle East, producers are now increasingly looking into plant integration building downstream capacity and to move further down the value chain. In Saudi Arabia, Saudi Aramco and SABIC, they signed a preliminary agreement to conduct a feasibility study on the development of a fully integrated crude oil to petrochemicals complex in Saudi Arabia. The aim is to relieve gas supply constraints the country has suffered in recent years and to reduce the dependence on crude oil export revenues. This preliminary study is expected to be completed by the third quarter of the year, and we'll look to build a fully integrated petrochemicals complex which maximises chemical yield, optimises resources, whilst diversifying the petrochemical feedstock mix in Saudi Arabia. The aim is also to create jobs to develop technology, especially in the area of downstream conversion of high-value specialty chemicals. This is an ongoing trend in the Middle East. After focusing many years on commodity petrochemical products, major producers in the Middle East are looking to expand capacity in high-value, high-margin, specialty-grade polymers. Petrochemical companies in the Middle East spent around $700 million in research and development in 2016, up from $300 million back in 2010. One significant example is the building of Sadara, which is a JV between Saudi Aramco and Dow Chemical. They're planning to build a petrochemicals complex capable of producing around 3 million metric tons of various petrochemical products, ranging from glycol ethers, elastomers, propylene oxide. Many of these products have never been produced in the Middle East before. Sadara will also be the first complex in Saudi Arabia to use naphtha as a key feedstock rather than natural gas. Petrorabi and Sipchem, they're also producers who will be looking at specialty-grade polymers. On the aromatic side, there have been a lot of investment as well, and we're expecting a lot more investments, capacity in aromatics, so in benzene, paraxylene, in the next few years, all of which are looking to use oil and naphtha as its feedstock. And what about Iran? How will recent developments in politics change the industry in Iran? Well, with the relief of economic and financial sanctions and the improvement of diplomatic ties, Iran has become a hotspot for investment. Iran ranks second in the world in terms of supply of conventional natural gas. Between $30 to $70 billion of investment opportunities in the petrochemical sector have already been identified. One example is the building of Iran's first methanol to olefins unit. So this unit will convert methanol, which is derived from natural gas, into products such as various olefins, so ethylene, but also gasoline as well. The aim is to use the huge gas reserves that Iran has. In terms of foreign investment, we've seen Total and Shell. They've shown interest to invest in oil and gas capabilities in Iran and have already signed provisional agreements with Iranian companies. Talks have been held with other major investors, such as in Japan, China, Germany, Italy, all looking to invest in Iran. Significant developments have already been made in the petrochemical side, with the West Ethylene Pipeline already partially operational. So this West Ethylene Pipeline, the idea is to bring ethylene production, which is situated in the southwest of the country, along the western coast, to feed the polymer units, which need ethylene to produce the polyethylene polymers. Various industry reports have said that Iran's petrochemical production, which was around 60 million metric tons in 2015, could grow by 50% to 100 million metric tons by 2020. Some are forecasting that capacity production could more than double to 130 million metric tons by 2020. Export volumes from Iran has risen significantly over the past year, which is evidence of Iran's renewed presence in the petrochemicals industry. Nevertheless, there are significant obstacles, relations with the US, which could undermine diplomatic ties, financing, Many of the new projects in Iran, they were announced decades ago, but it's taken them years and years to secure the necessary financing. So the question remains, to what extent and in what time frame can these new Iranian projects actually come into fruition? So in conclusion, to recap on the megatrends and to conclude what these trends would mean for the Russian petrochemicals industry. So the feedstock environment has changed. Using ethane as a feedstock instead of naphtha no longer has a strong cost advantage. The US shale gas boom has also lowered production economics. The main investments by Russian companies on the cracker side will be gas-based, utilizing Russia's huge gas reserves. Russian companies are moving down the value chain and producing more polymers to be less dependent on imports. And if all their investments announced come to fruition, then we expect Russia and Eastern Europe to be in a small net surplus of polymers by 2020. Higher production of US shale will mean new capacity of ethylene and polyethylene will be built in the US. There'll also be growth in US shale exports, and more petrochemical crackers globally will become reliant on US shale. Middle East is shifting its focus to downstream polymer production on high-value, high-margin, specialty-grade products. Iran's presence will also grow, and we expect more and more capacity and more exports to come out of Iran. Producers in the US, Middle East, and Iran will focus exports primarily on Asia, which is the largest deficit region for polymers, and the region to see the highest growth prospects for polymers. So for Russian companies looking to export polymers, they'll see a fight for market share. However, Russia would be relatively shielded from a flood of polymer imports, as the focus for US and Middle Eastern companies would be to feed the large deficits in Asia. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.